Good morning, everyone. I hope you all have had an opportunity to grab something to drink, something to eat during the break, and we'll go ahead and get started. So if we can all be seated and so we can go into the next session, where does encryption happen? I'd like to introduce our speakers. Our first speaker is Nick Sullivan. He is a leading cryptography and security technologist. As head of security engineering at CloudFlare, one of the world's leading web security companies. He is responsible for the company's cryptographic products and strategy. Prior to joining CloudFlare, he was a digital rights management pioneer, helping to build and secure Apple's multi-billion dollar iTunes store. He is the author of over a dozen computer security patents and holds a Master of Science in Cryptography and a Bachelor's in Math in Pure Mathematics. Next, we have Kimber. She is an innovation specialist at 18F and a mission information specialist at NASA with a background in security research, penetration testing, incident response, security policy, and network security. She speaks and conducts trainings at security conferences throughout the US. And basically, she breaks things, fixes things, and gets root for fun and profit. Next, we have Allan Friedman. He has spent the past decade and a half bouncing between computer science and economics in the academic and think tank world, specializing in the economics of information security. He recently joined the National Telecommunication and Information Administration in the U.S. Department of Commerce and just announced a new multi-stakeholder initiative on vulnerability research disclosure. And finally, we have Dlshad, a technologist with the Information Safety and Capacity Project, a group that works closely with civil society and media groups protecting freedom of expression. So just to give a little bit of framing for this session, where does encryption happen, we're going to be covering a couple of different concepts here. We're going to go through an explanation of encryption. We're going to chart the internet as we know it, talk about the different types of encryption, where doesn't encryption touch, and then in the last 15 minutes of this session, we're going to have a Q&A to open it up for you all to ask our panelists questions. So we'll go ahead and jump right in with an explanation of encryption.
Shad, you want to start off?
Hello.
Well, yeah, why don't you, so we can get a better lay of the audience. Who feels like they have a very good technical understanding of crypto? Okay, so that's about half. So we'll try to even that out a little bit more. Is it on?
Thanks. Actually, encryption, to explain encryption in a simple language, is a way actually to send a message from a sender to a receiver and actually prevent access from an authorized party to read that message. So this is how simple it is we can explain encryption. Encryption is all about encrypting information regardless what is the type of information that we're trying to transfer. So historically, it's used during wars, it's used in many different ways that it actually prevented unauthorized party to get access to encryption. So I will try my best actually to keep encryption in the modern concept of encryption, to speak about encrypting information on the modern age. So the largest, or actually the most important point where encryption got to a modern level was when Professor Shannon, or Claude Shannon, actually wrote his own theory of information back in the 40s. Actually, Shannon was a mathematician / electrical engineer, and he used to work in communications. So the largest problem that Shannon had was actually try to transfer voice calls without noise. So in the old analog systems, transferring voice, noise was a big problem. And as far as communications are actually destination between the sender or receiver are far, noise is going to be more, it's getting to be bigger and bigger. And that actually is killing the communication. So the whole idea was about the trying to remove the noise from the call. So Shannon's theory is actually found the fundamental basis of how we can measure the size of information. And based on his theory, the modern concept of bits and bytes and kilobytes and megabytes actually came from that theory. So for Shannon was his theory was actually in a math language. Let's explain it this way: how we can get information from an X point to Z point through a signal, and we have to find the capacity of that signal that it's going to hold this information. So that helped actually Shannon and other people to calculate the amount of noise it might actually accuse or getting into that signal or that data that's moving from the X point to Z point. So to say that, finding the size of or being able to measure this, the capacity of transfer of signals or carriers of information, it's also easy for us to measure the size of let's say the noise that it's gonna carry in that. Now I want to go out from the theory of information to the applied actually usage of theory of information. The modern encryption actually, which I can describe it as a symmetric or asymmetric encryption. Now we're saying it's getting into usage of the theory of information. So, for example, if I'm trying to encrypt a specific amount of a specific message, I will be able actually to figure out also the size of the key that I have to use to encrypt that message. Now, getting into the symmetric key or explaining how symmetric key works, symmetric key is actually an algorithm that it uses shared secret key. So to encrypt a specific an X amount of data, we have to use that shared secret key. At the same time, to decipher that encrypted content that we have to use the same shared secret that we're going to use to encrypt and decrypt. The problem in symmetric encryption algorithm was actually how we can transfer that shared key in a secure way. Because if I'm going to send a message that it's encrypted, at the same time, I need to send that key that I used to encrypt that message. So who is going to carry that key to be transferred to the other party? So here we came to something called asymmetric encryption, which is a mathematical algorithm that it helps to encrypt, to actually generate two set of keys, which is a private key and public key. And from its names, private key is a key that I have to keep, and public key is a public key. It's a key that I can send to people. So if I want to send a message using my set of encryption, I will use my private, the public key of the receiver, actually, to encrypt that message using my private key at the same time. So my private key and the receiver's public key to encrypt that message. And I will be sending that message. The receiver already has his own private key that is going to use it to decipher the encrypted message.
So that being said, for encryption, how does that lay out with the rest of the internet? So in thinking about the different points, we need to kind of take a step back and think about how do we chart this out in relation to the internet?
Let's chart the internet, shall we?
Yeah, so the internet is, it's not, it's tubes, an abstract concept. No, it's not a series
of
tubes. It's not a cloud. It's not something that you look at and think abstractly. Oh, this is the internet. I type into my computer and I'm there. It's a physical thing. It has components that live in physical reality, and we're gonna chart this out right here. And the internet is a network of networks. So. A network is a set of computers that can all talk to each other. So let's start from something very basic. You have a telephone, and you want to get to a website from that telephone. How do the bits and bytes, the pieces of information, go from one place to another? So in this example right here, your telephone has a radio in it. And this radio talks to a radio tower, a cell phone tower. And that cell phone tower is owned by your service provider, or whether that's AT&T or Verizon, or basically the owner of this tower. And they are a network. They're one of the many networks on the internet. And networks will come together in physical locations and exchange information. There's this concept of an internet exchange. It's where Verizon or AT&T will connect with another network, whether it's level 3 or one of the other large networks in the world. And this isn't an abstract thing. It's a physical thing. There are buildings, whether it's here or in New York or traditionally in port locations like Singapore and London, there are these large buildings where you have physical machines called routers, and you plug cables from one to the other. And so if you're going to send information from one cell phone to another, it goes from your cell phone over wireless communication signals to a cell phone tower, which is then connected through wires to an internet exchange, and that connects to the other network for which you're trying to communicate to, and it goes all the way down the line to the next endpoint. So with cell phones is one example. Another example here is personal computers. So your network in your house is all the computers that you have, or say, for example, this conference center. Everybody here is connected through the internet. It all goes through one central routing point, and that connects to the service provider, which then connects to the internet exchange and goes to wherever the destination is. And this is the same situation that you have for individual people connecting to the internet as companies do, or service providers, or basically websites as well. A data center is just like a very large room that has a lot of computers connected together through a central router. This is not your little blue box with the antenna. It's something called Big Iron. It's a giant multi-$1,000 router, but essentially it's the same thing. It takes all the messages that are bound to other networks from inside your network and goes and routes it to the correct place. So you can go from your phone to a data center, and it all goes through these interconnected networks, interconnection points called internet exchanges, and these exist all over the world.
I'm wondering, does it matter from the technical perspectives, where you're to talk about the security of the data, does it matter whether I'm talking by the phone or computer or data center? Does the protocol make a difference?
Well, one of the great things about the internet is that it uses a common protocol called the IP. You might have heard of it, the Internet Protocol. So every single one of these pieces speaks the same language. And every piece that's connected to the internet is theoretically routable to any other place. So if you send it to a central location, they know how to send your information to the right place. And whether it's over wireless communications, whether it's over satellite communications, whether it's over electronic signals on wires, such as phone wires, or across the ocean through fiber optic cables that go under the ocean, they still, on the surface level, speak the same language.
So I think this is a great model that you set up here. And a couple of things we can say about it. From a commercial perspective, this is all privately held infrastructure that's run by different companies.
Who are those companies?
Well, it depends at what layer we're talking about. And the great thing is, it doesn't matter what company it is. Some industries are highly concentrated. Some are very competitive. But because we have this notion of routability, they can all talk to each other. But what's incredible is it's all ad hoc as well. That as we develop new technologies or new business models, we can add new aspects to this. Now, this sometimes creates some issues. It means we forgot about security at certain parts, and we have to figure out ways to build that in. But it also means that we can have new innovations as long as they fit into this general model of routability. We can have infinite extensibility. So
briefly, do we want to touch on the OSI model?
Yeah, because right now, this is all the pipes. So I don't use the internet just for the sheer joy of sending packets. I like to do stuff.
Who likes to do stuff on the internet? Do you know who's watching you when you do it, or do you care? Dlshad, do you want to talk about that?
Absolutely, sure. So the OSI model is actually the basic foundation of how data moves in the network, or actually how we are processing data in our daily usage of network. So I will start by describing the OSI model, or the layers actually of that process. So we will start with the physical layer of the OSI model, which is the physical connectors that we're using, for example, like the cables, fiber. these are the carrier of bits that they are leaving our devices and are going to another from source to a destination. Then we will be talking about the data link. So the data link is actually, it's the actual link between two nodes. Let's say there are two nodes, they are talking to each other. So the data link is the responsible, is the layer that it's responsible of connecting two nodes or allowing two nodes to establish a data link between each other. Then we will be talking about a network layer, which is for example, the IP. IP is part of the network level. So first we will establish, we will use a carrier to move the data. Then we will have a data link that is going to link these connectors with each other. Then we will establish the network. So IP is an example of a network of a network that it's in the layer of network actually. Then we will use the transport. So the transport is, let's say we have two IPs now, how we're going to transport data between each other. So we're going to use TCP or UDP, for example. These are the transport layer. Then we will establish a session. Let's say we established a TCP at the point before. What are we going to establish? So we're going to establish a session, and that can be an HTTP connection, for example. Then we will start using, we will go forward to the session layer. So after we established an HTTP, sorry, a presentation layer, after we established an HTTP connection, for example, at the session layer, what are we going to exchange? So we're going to exchange, we're talking now about a presentation layer, which is responsible actually to translate data that it's receiving from the session. So for example, we're getting an ASCII, for example, data. So we have to translate that ASCII code or decode it. So the presentation layer is actually responsible for that. Then we're going to application layer, and this is the wide range of applications that we're talking about, like Internet Explorer, like Firefox, that they are using all of these steps or all of these OSI models actually to transfer data or to send and receive data.
So I guess my question for everybody would be, why should you care, right? Why should you care how the internet works? Why should you care about the OSI model? Why should you care about encryption? And I think privacy. Do you want to speak to privacy? Do you want to, like?
I'm for it, but.
I mean, I think that the next step probably here is talking about different types of encryption, right? And what that can do for you on a privacy level. So you're only as secure or as encrypted as your most encrypted hop. When you leap through all these steps, you know, you might think you're safe on the phone side because you've got a lock code on your phone, which does nothing, by the way. But say you're connecting to a site that's not protected, encrypted.
Well, let's start with the device.
I
want to make sure that the data, if I lose my phone, someone picks it up and can't access the data. So how does that work?
So if you put a lock code on your phone, is that what you're thinking? Mm-hmm. So I get your phone, it's got a lock code on it, right? Yeah, or your fingerprint. Oh, I love bio, right? So you've got that on your phone. Do we just break the bad news now? Or encrypt your phone, right? The lock code's not really going to do much. I can bypass that. Most Red Hats are going to be able to bypass that. Most black hats are going to bypass that. Your bio, yeah, you can bypass that. There's tape. You've seen CSI. Most of TV isn't true. That part is. You can lift a fingerprint off the phone and fake the fingerprint. The type of data on your phone, though, if you think about what's on your phone and why it's important to protect it, because you may think, oh, you know what? I'm not doing anything bad. I don't care, right? If you think about the types of things on your phone, I guess we could move over to data at rest. We could talk about.
So if you say encrypt my phone, what does that mean, right? I just install something and it says, great, this is now encrypted. But what actually happened?
So what actually happens, I guess, is the data on your phone becomes sort of encapsulated by a protective layer that I would say scrambles, for lack of a better word. It's going to scramble all the stuff on your phone, and you have the key that unlocks it, right? So if I get your phone and you've scrambled it up and I don't have the key, I mean, there's a pretty good chance I'm going to probably give up and move on to the next guy whose phone isn't encrypted. But on the off chance I want to hit it, I'm going to have to run it through some steps to decrypt it. And it's probably going to take longer than I really ever want to spend on hacking a phone. Unless he's a government employee, and then maybe I would spend a little more time on it. Just saying.
Some people,
those black hats.
Sure, yeah, and if you have information on your phone that's encrypted and your phone is off, then someone gets your phone and they can't do anything with it without you entering in an authentication code, some sort of identifying piece that tells the phone, yes, this is really me, and allows you to unlock cryptographically all the information. But when your phone's running, it doesn't necessarily have that, because if you have information that's encrypted, you can't do anything with it. You can't search through encrypted information. You can't have anything on your screen, because everything that's rendered on the screen is real bits and bytes that's in your computer's memory.
So I'd only use my phone for Twitter. If I do real stuff, I'm using my computer. How can I encrypt the data that's on my computer? How does that work?
Well, actually, there are many applications that helps you to encrypt the data that it's in rest. That's how we call it, data in rest. That's data it's stored on your storage, regardless if it's smartphone or laptop. So using an encryption software that it's going to encrypt or cipher the content that it's on your computer, and then generate a key that you are the only person who has access to that key. The minute that you want to get access to your information, you have to decrypt maybe the whole disk if you have a full disk encryption, or you have to decrypt a particular folder or block or whatever that you already encrypted in using that key. So this is how you are actually preventing an unauthorized party to get access to your storage in case they had physical access to it.
But what if I run a website and I've got storage on a server somewhere that is not in my possession?
Well, in cloud, actually, there are specific software that it helps you to encrypt the data before uploading it to the cloud. So the minute that you're going to upload data to the cloud, you have to encrypt it, then upload it. If you want to get that data and use it, you have to download it and decrypt it. So it's going to be the same, actually, mechanism, but just downloading it from the internet and uploading it to the internet.
So lots of people who keep data on the cloud actually keep it encrypted at rest. Now, the problem is, for the most part, if it's encrypted, you can't do anything useful with it. So if you want to, you know, you have a database, you want to mine it, you have, you know, your customer's traffic, and you want to serve them appropriate ads that they'll be interested in, if it's encrypted, you can't do much with it. There is the dream of computer scientists, something called homomorphic encryption. We've got that down. That's very computationally intensive. It used to take to the heat death of the universe. Now it's just going to take to the heat death of the solar system. We're slowly making progress. But by and large, if you're going to do something with data at rest, you're going to have to decrypt it in part. And that means that someone's going to be vulnerable, especially if you're trying to then send it to someone else to do something useful with it.
And I don't want to get too crazy technical, but I feel a sort of moral obligation to let you know that even if you take steps to encrypt your laptop, okay, so your laptop's encrypted, maybe use PGP, something like that, semantic products, and so you're all set up that you enter your password before your machine boots, right? So you think you're good, and you lock your screen and walk away, okay? All the information that I need to get your keys is stored in the unencrypted part of your hard drive's memory. So just be aware that, you know, I just feel a responsibility to let you know that encryption is not foolproof. If you encrypt end to end, great, it's a great start. You walk away from your box with the screen locked and a black hat comes by and there's a way to extract that information. So just be more, you know, be diligent. That's my little spiel. But be diligent. Log out of your box if you're not using it. Shut it down, even better. Then there's nothing stored anywhere in your temporary memory. But that's just, there you go.
So that's a good point, and this is something to bring up end-to-end is a topic that you mentioned. But before we get there, let's talk about the internet and how information flows. Right now, we've talked about endpoints, we've talked about servers, and information at one point or another. When you're transferring information across all of these networks, every single one of these steps, you're broadcasting information such that anybody along the way, any organization that has access to any one of these machines, and there are hundreds and hundreds of machines and different types of cables and different types of broadcast media for which, if you're going from a phone to a data center, you have to hop all the way along. Well,
but I know that, so my phone has to talk to a tower to use data.
Right.
But surely the phone company means that, has made it so that no one else can eavesdrop and listen in on that data traffic, right?
Who would do that?
And it's true, yeah. Every single one of these hops has some layer of encryption built in. So if you think about Wi-Fi here in this network, you had to enter in the password, which is right up there, Internet 360. And that password allows you to access the network and get some sort of encryption layer between you and the router. But then it gets unencrypted. And then from the router to the next step, it has its own layer of encryption. And sort of every step along the line, there is a chance of it being encrypted or not, depending on how people configured or set up each of these pieces along the way. So so
I know that I'm supposed to look for the little lock icon. That means that I'm secure.
Right. If you're talking about the web, that's one way to ensure that any one of these hops along the way, even if they are able to decrypt the message, you have another layer of encryption on top. So HTTPS is a technology from, it was invented around 20 years ago by Netscape, and it's also known as SSL, or now TLS is the more accepted term for it, but it allows you as a web user to encrypt data between your browser and the website that you're going to. And it uses public key cryptography. So as you may recall, going on the web, there's a little lock icon on some sites. If it starts with HTTPS, you'll see that. And click on that, and you get something called a certificate. And a certificate is a sort of, it's really a certificate, but it's something that a certificate authority, which is an organization that has the authority to identify a website, has given that website that says, yes, I assert that you are the owner of www.accessnow.org. And it contains in it a public key that you can use to establish a connection between your browser and the website. And so even if any of these hops here, even if any of those pipes of the Internet Exchange, which typically are not encrypted, your data going through it already has been encrypted from your browser to the server, and from the server back.
So we've got our layer model up there, and we've got some network encryption, we've got the app layer encryption through some of these approaches. So Dlshad, you work with people that really depend on having strong crypto. Is it enough just to say, look for the little lock?
No, actually, in cases like in many conflict areas, actually, this layer of encryption is not enough, especially, for example, I'm using Gmail. Gmail is HTTPS, but this is not enough because the content of the message is actually not encrypted. So here we're going to talk about a different layer of encryption, which is end-to-end encryption. So how can I actually send a message using a secure layer like HTTPS, but even preventing the server owner like Google, for example, from getting access to my Gmail, or a third party that has got my password, for example, from reading my emails. So end-to-end encryption is a way that you can encrypt your emails. For example, PGP is one way of end-to-end encryption implementation. So as I described before, public and private keys. I have private key and I have public key of the receiver. I will encrypt the email using that layer of network or application or service or whatever, and I will submit that message. The other end, they have their private key, and they will decrypt that message. So this is a different layer. And so I think this lock is not enough.
Right, so you take your message, you wrap it in an envelope, and send it across these tubes that are the internet, and only the other person who has the key can unwrap it. So that leads to another problem, which is how do you manage those keys? And how do you keep track of your own key and make sure that no other person can decrypt these messages?
So there's a saying in for people who build this stuff for a living that says crypto is easy, it's just math. Key management is really hard, because if you are trying to make sure that your private key is kept secure, that's one challenge. And if you're an organization that depends on having a private key, often you'll have to go for a hardware solution. Here's a physical box, and there are technical standards that have been developed at NIST that say this is tamper-resistant or tamper-proof, and that's how we keep it. But it's not just enough to manage that. I also have to know that your public key is safe. That if, you know, Dlshad says this, if someone says, I'm Dlshad, here's my public key, how do I really know? And there are decentralized ways to deploy this, and there are commercial ways to deploy this, but they're fairly technical. And only recently did we develop a technology through the Oasis Consortium to get these different systems to talk together. So it's a really interesting point. One of the other problems is, what happens if I lose my key? Well, if I've engaged in true at-rest disk encryption, and I have lost my key, and I come to my friendly neighborhood tech person, and I say, I've lost my key. When I lose the key to the front door, I need a locksmith. Can you give me my data back?
Legally or not legally?
I have really good crypto.
And the integrity of the data would be garbage at that point. So, yeah, if you lose your key, you're kind of hosed. There's a little application. Some of you have heard of it. GPG key, right? You'll note that in the GPG application, you have the option to delete your key and recreate it. And this is probably specifically for cases like this. You go to unlock the file, or you go to decrypt the message, and it prompts you for your password, right? The key to your key, basically. And you can't for the life of you remember what it was. You're kind of done, then you got to just recreate the key. So it's, you know.
And if we're in a world that depends on me trusting your key, we need a system for key revocation. The sure. ability for you to communicate to everyone, hey, you remember that key that I used to use? Maybe a bad guy is now using it. So don't trust anything that comes from me. And that has to be done fairly, that has to be done at scale. So we're starting to talk about some fairly complex systems here.
Yeah, so one thing to note about PGP is that if you lose your key, yes, your data is gone, there's nothing you can do. But if someone were to steal your key, they can retroactively go and decrypt all your messages. So one thing in the crypto community that is sort of very popular now and people are talking about is the concept of forward secrecy. What this does is allows you to encrypt something with your key such that if sometime in the future you lose your master key, your private key, no person who has, say, recorded a conversation can go back in time and record it. So this is something that HTTPS is implementing, and a protocol called OTR, off the record, which is a way to have asynchronous communication that's end-to-end encrypted, but also forward secret. So that's another thing to keep in mind.
And you guys can all go home and do that right now. You can all just go home and install OTR. It's a plugin. It's like not a big deal. It's not hard. And you can use it with your Gmail account and, you know, OTR, off the record. So it's great.
So speaking of things that we may encourage people to go home and experiment with, you hear a lot about this Tor product. Now, if I have good encryption, if I have my data encrypted on my machine and I'm using some sort of end-to-end communication device, why do I need to worry about this tool that everyone's talking about?
Well, I'm so glad you asked. So basically what Tor is going to do is let you browse the web, right? But are we going to talk about metadata now, or yeah?
Okay. Let's talk metadata.
Let's talk metadata.
I think everyone now knows, like, metadata is now in the public domain. People know this term, so
right. It's important. Everybody kind of understands metadata. It's the little the little parts that are kind of tucked away that don't get encrypted when you browse, even when you're on an encrypted connection.
Right. I mean, you need to tell the network where to go to get send your message. And to do that, you need to know who you are and who you're sending information to. And that's built into the IP network. It's IP addresses are those four numbers with dots, and hopefully they'll be more than IPv6, which is coming up, which is more than four numbers with colons in between. But the four numbers with dots identify computers on the internet, and if you want to send a message from one computer to the other, you give it a list of numbers with dots.
So why would anyone care about my IP address?
Well, if we will go back to the OSI model and the metadata topic, there are parts in the OSI models, they really need real information. They need real information to talk to each other to deliver the message. So Tor is actually an app that is trying, it's a solution actually, and it's an implementation for Onion Network that it gives you access through other people's computers. So you're using other people's metadata to go through. And this actually goes through three layers in Tor network. So you're actually using somebody else's metadata three times. So that actually changes the whole route of your information, and it removes the trace where it came from. Now, why I need that? Because in part of these huge pipes, there are many parts they can't follow the metadata and find where data came from and where it's going. Even it's encrypted. For example, I live in a place like Syria, and I'm connecting to a VPN server in Washington, D.C. And my government can really know that I'm using VPN. They can know that I'm connecting to this IP address. Let's do a little bit search to find who owns this IP address. Well, it's X organization. Come on. I mean, it's clear that I work with this organization. So using this metadata is enough, actually, to find what are you doing.
So, and also, you used a word that we haven't talked about yet, which is a VPN. I know that when I travel internationally, I use a VPN, but why do I do that?
Sure, yeah, VPN is, it stands for Virtual Private Network, and it's a way to hop through these pipes and come out as someone else. So a VPN server would be operating in a data center, say in another country, and if you want to browse as if you are coming from that, say, Amsterdam, there are quite a few VPNs there. If you have VPN provider, you pay something like $10 a year or more if you want more security. But let's just say you have a VPN provider. They have a server in Amsterdam. You can encrypt your connection. You sort of set up a private network overlaid on top of this network to that VPN, and that's where you would enter the internet, and that's where you would seem like you are from. So your IP address would look like, okay, this is an IP address of some organization inside of the Netherlands.
But and adding to that, right, that also is going to encrypt your data. So if you're let's say you're at Starbucks, right? We'll use an example. Everybody, you've taken your laptop to Starbucks to do some work, right? You're browsing the web. I mean, somebody can see everything that you're doing if they want to see it. It's not, I need my little 13-inch MacBook. I don't need much to pop a Starbucks network and watch everything you're doing.
Even if there's a password on the Wi-Fi network?
Even if there's a password on the Wi-Fi network. That adds maybe 10 minutes to my hunt. So, so if you're at the Starbucks, right, this is a thing you do, WFS, work from Starbucks, that's a thing, right? So chances are if you're trying to access your things at work, right, you're logging into your work's VPN, and you're probably doing that with some sort of password, maybe a soft token, your little RSA thing, you know, it's securing your connection. That's great, okay, that's perfect, right, because then you've sort of put a wall between you and the Starbucks network, and now you're using your, let's just say, federal VPN, right? You're shopping on Amazon, you're paying your bills, whatever. Keep in mind, you're now on your government's network or your employer's network, and they can monitor your traffic over VPN. So let's all be clear that if you're going to conduct private things with your PII, right, maybe you should have your own VPN. These things are super cheap. $35 bucks a year you pay. You get to put them on up to 5 devices. If you're not running a VPN on your phone, I would say to you, why not? It's cheap. it kind of protects you, and it adds that layer of encryption, which is what we're talking about, integrity, privacy, and there's just no reason not to do it. But I sort of went off on a tangent about VPNs. So
we've covered quite a few types of technology that people use to encrypt, and most of these are completely open source and available to anybody on the internet. And we've mapped out what the internet is, and I think the part that we haven't covered is where on the internet is data not encrypted? What are we missing? If this is not the ideal world for everybody, but say that the ideal world is everything is encrypted, where are the gaps?
Actually, data in rest in a company's data center are not encrypted, mostly because at the end of the day, you need access. And company need access to index this information, for example, or to get access to, or to organize it, or to use it. Now, where data reverse the question and ask where data is encrypted actually over the internet. So I would say in places like mostly companies that they care about users, they encrypt their passwords, for example, in their databases, or they encrypt some contents that it doesn't have to be a plain text, again, like password. So these are the only parts that they are encrypted on the internet. That's why sometimes end-to-end encryption is actually the solution to protect your privacy.
So talking about some of the solutions that people might be able to sort of implement in the marketplace, we've been hearing a lot of push, both in the public sector or private sector and in government, to have companies, large, small government agencies, implement at least the first hop, sort of getting data as it goes to the data center through transport layer security, or HTTPS. Why is that hard, and how do we make it easier? I know that both of you have been working on that.
Well, so I'll speak to part of it and pass to you. So why haven't we flipped the switch, right? Why haven't we flipped the switch from HTTP to HTTPS? Why don't we just do it, right? Secure all the things. Right.
Geeks can do anything in a single...
Yeah, we just click the mouse. You know, why do we have half of our government agencies on IPv4 and the other half on IPv6? Why don't we just flip the switch? We know the standard, you know, by the time we go to 6, they're going to be up to 10. Okay, so money, right? It costs a lot of money to get people into a room to rewrite code, right? We've got legacy systems. We've got entire foundations that depend on a structure that's 10 years old, 15 years old. What are we going to do? We also have a money constraint. It comes down to money, really, right? We have a money constraint with hardware. We've got a lot of legacy hardware. We've got a lot of equipment that just frankly can't handle flipping the switch. We need, you know, we need more power, we need more computers, we need more RAM, we need more space, we need more people, we need people who are technically savvy, we need people who care about this stuff to enter the workforce and work for the federal government if we're going to talk about the feds. So that's a piece of it,
and,
right?
And I think the most important point is that we have the rest of the world where they have a very slow infrastructure, so encryption means more processing, need more internet speed. So the world is still not ready to receive that.
So you're essentially saying, Kimber, that the future of our privacy and our security is jeopardized by our historical technical debt. How do we
move forward
past all this technical debt that we have as we develop solutions?
Well, it's a hard question. As we've spoke about today, encryption is mathematics, and mathematics requires computers to add and count and multiply numbers together. And encryption adds, you know, some significant computation on top of it. Luckily, the industry through the last 10 years or so has thought about this, and that has been one of the focuses of many people throughout the industry, not only hardware vendors such as Intel, but software as a service, cloud vendors. People have been thinking about how to cheaply, and not cheaply as in shoddily, but cheaply as in inexpensively, add encryption into the technology. So the latest generation of computers that are out there, whether it's the processor in your phone, the latest iPhones or Intel's processors from the past 5 years have cryptography built into it so that it does not cost very much. But as you said, Jamie, and as is very clear, technology moves slowly, and changing which computers you have that run your service, whether it's a government service or a private corporation, this takes time, money, and expertise. But the industry is providing solutions so that, what is it called? It's every 18 months computing gets...
Moore's Law.
Moore's Law applies to the price of cryptography even more so, because it's a really strong focus area of a lot of technical people.
And you look to the private sector and you see that there is a lot of great products that are being deployed now. So for example, to call out, since Nick is not the sort to plug his own company, there are companies that sort of offer HTTPS as part of their services, as part of their content delivery network services. And there the challenge is saying, well, I can connect to my content delivery network, which gives the data locally, through a secure channel. But then the back end may not be encrypted. And so companies are working with their customers to make that more secure. But if
so, you may have seen the acronym. He's talking about CDN, Charlie Delta. What's the N? November, right? Thanks. So if you've seen that, that's what we're talking about now.
Yeah, so a lot of websites nowadays use third-party services, and they have for a while, about 15 years, to help accelerate the website. So if there are pieces of your website that are constant, static things like images that don't change very often, you can offload that to a third party who may have a wider, more distributed network so that when someone's trying to get that data, they don't have to go very far. One of the constraints of browsing the internet in a fast way is really the speed of light. If the computer you're connecting to is across the Pacific Ocean, there's no shortcut. You have to, through a fiber, send a beam of light with an oscillating signal that has to actually transfer data across the entire Pacific. So there is time constraints. What CDNs give you is the ability to move content closer to the people who are viewing it.
So Department of Commerce, we like to look for sort of private sector innovations. One of the areas that I've been looking at is the usability side, because this stuff is all really important, but at the same time, even as qualified geeks that we all are, it takes us a little while to set this stuff up. And I think one of the innovations we've seen is more and more companies rolling these technologies into user-friendly approaches. But I'd love to hear, where do you guys think the industry is going? What are we going to see in encryption in the future, from the research world or from the advocacy community or from the private sector?
I think after the privacy issue became a big thing, I see now more people are really, they care about encryption. So I see more money in this industry, and that actually leads to more people to talk to each other. So usually geeks or developers are really, they have their own world. They think everybody understands TCP, like myself now when I talked about TCP. So nobody really think that the rest of the people, they really can get exactly what they are going to provide them. So user-friendly encryption solutions is a big problem. But recently, I've seen a lot of companies, big companies, they start to care about that and invest more money to bring people who they are using encryption to the geek and let them talk to each other to find a middle ground solution that it can be good encryption, strong encryption, at the same time, user-friendly. I think this is what we're going to see the next step. And this is the biggest problem, actually, that we have now, and it should be addressed.
So I could speak to this for some just user-friendly solutions for yourselves. You know, this isn't necessarily going to translate to your daily jobs unless you're a reporter. But companies like Keybase is a beta, keybase.io. If you want to visit their site, they're doing great work. Right now it's by invitation only. But they're basically trying to do just that, put keys, key management into a user-friendly GUI, a user-friendly environment. So you go, just like you'd sign up for Facebook, right? You go, you sign up for Keybase, you get a public key, then all of a sudden you've got a username on Keybase, and if I want to send somebody a message, I can say, oh, here, go to keybase.io/Kimber and get my public key. Then, if you're on Keybase, you can just send me an encrypted message right through Keybase. They don't store your private keys on their servers. So, you know, it's a very nice little web app that they've built. It's integrated with GPG. So if you're using GPG with public and private keys, you can actually on your personal systems, your work systems, you can import those into Keybase. You can use the public key you already have. You don't have to make a new one. So it's very nice for the purposes of identifying that you're talking to who you actually think you're talking to.
Right, that key management problem that right. Allan was talking about.
Right. Another company that I've been working, using their beta for a while is Proton Mail. So protonmail.ch. They've just actually opened up a .com too. Like you can do a .com if you don't want to do ch. They're based out of Switzerland. If you've got a Proton Mail account and the person you're emailing has a Proton Mail account, well, your messages are just encrypted. That's just it. Because they had to use an encryption key to get into their account, and you had to use one to get into yours. They've also recently just added to the beta the ability to encrypt attachments. So that was huge for those of us who want to send encrypted attachments.
Right, and it's not just startups who are doing this. For example, Google and Yahoo are working on their own end-to-end solution inside of their mail protocols. As you may or may not know, Gmail, yes, you are encrypted to Google servers, but on the back end, there's a whole other infrastructure of internet mail, email, and there has been a recent push to get some of it encrypted with something called Start TLS, but mostly email messages are sent over all of these wires completely unencrypted. So that's another gap, I guess, in the encryption
story. So that's
story.
That's what I was going to mention here, is that we're talking about private sector innovations regarding user-friendly products or existing encryption technologies, just making them a little bit easier for anybody to use. But, you know, we are talking also about where encryption doesn't touch, or areas where we know that there's a lack of encryption. And do any of you feel that there's enough private sector innovation and focus, or even academic focus, on those areas to start looking for solutions that are easier to implement?
Well, so right now, the buzzword right now is the Internet of Things, right? So all the things that are touching the Internet that aren't getting encryption. So think about things like medical devices, smart refrigerators, elevators even, all these things that are getting updates from the Internet, that are talking to the Internet. If you think about even things, which this is kind of scary to me, right? CPAP machines, you know, if you're familiar, if you have sleep apnea, you get the CPAP machine and it helps you sleep. It's got a little wireless card in it, and that wireless card sends information back to, you know, your medical provider and says, oh, and then he's not getting enough breath at this time. Let me adjust it. And wirelessly, they talk right back to that CPAP machine and adjust how much oxygen you get. That's kind of scary because that's not encrypted, right?
So, and I think that touches, going back to what you were saying earlier, that there are different roles that we need from encryption. There's the confidentiality aspect. You know, do I want people to know how much oxygen I'm getting at night? But there's also the integrity aspect. Is the data that is received by my doctor, or even more importantly, the data that's received by the machine, the data that was sent by my doctor, has someone tampered with it in the middle? And we haven't gotten too much into that, but I think an important role that all these systems also offer is maintaining integrity, which is absolutely critical. On the previous panel, we talked about how, listen, encryption is important for national security. It's important for everyone's security. And the integrity side is absolutely critical. One of the risks as we move to embedded devices being further out into the world is they're made by a lot more people, which is great. That's innovation. Now everyone's a software company. And we have to relearn a lot of the lessons about security. We have to relearn the lessons that encryption isn't just use the library. It's use the library perfectly. Because if you don't use the library perfectly, that opens a chink for an attacker to get in. And then the devices themselves, right? This now has plenty of processing power, more than the space shuttle has. But, you know, the devices, my internet fridge, as everyone likes to talk about, may not have as many gates, may not be able to do all of this powerful computation that we need. So as the research community needs to come together and figure out how can we do the security side, the encryption side, with less power, and at the same time, with less interface. So, right, with the
keyboard, with the phone, we know how to use them. There is not, to my knowledge, an Institute for Human-Fridge Interaction. We may have to start working on that as we expect more devices to automatically understand what's going on in the environment around us. We're going to need to interact with them.
But I do think that should be a thing.
The Institute for Human-Fridge.
Yes.
I think it's also a responsibility for companies or for developers or software maker to tell you what exactly these devices are sharing, what information are sharing, what information are sending and receiving at the same time. And that will help also the research community. I mean, smart refrigerator, what type of information is exchanging? I have to know until I can, as a part of this security research, until I can think about a solution for that also. There should be kind of protocols actually between the technology makers at the same time, the security research, so they can't talk to each other. And there is a lack in that, actually.
For instance, if you have a web nanny cam, right? Everybody loves nanny cams. And you can log in, and you love that you can log in and check the website and see your nanny cams. How is that, what's happening from the camera, right, to the point the camera turns on, to the point that you can see your camera on the website? How many hops did that data make? That visual information, what did it take with it? Did it take your IP address with it? Did it take your physical location with it? Did it take pictures of your children with it, unencrypted across? You know, these are things that you may not necessarily think about because so many things now, I mean, it's great, right? Plug and play, exercise caution when you plug and play. You know, the same way you would interview the nanny and run the check, right? Interview the nanny cam specs, read your terms of service, see what kind of information they're passing, and then you can make the decision about whether or not, one, you want to use that camera, two, you need to increase the level of encryption in your home, how you're, you know, what do you need to do? There's so many layers here in this amazing diagram behind us, by the way.
Kimber, do you feel that there's a lack of transparency around the types of encryption and where the encryption is used in commercial and consumer grade products? And does there need to be more transparency?
There absolutely should be more transparency across the board with information that's being shared, information that's being encrypted or not encrypted, as 90% of the internet is not encrypted, by the way.
It's more than 90.
Yeah, I know. I was just trying to be nice, but...
So I think one of the impressive things about encryption is that it's heavily standardized. And in fact, the community is quite good at shaming people who try to roll their own, or who talk about how they have military-grade encryption, which is something, because I think we have very good standards. We have experts who come together and understand when it's time to move to the next level. We heard about that on the previous panel. The transparency gap may be in fitting this into our risk models. The technical level seems to be, we have that aspect well. How do we integrate that into our overall risk modeling from everyday life, the nanny cam, CSI cyber scenario?
I'm not gonna.
We all watched it.
Yeah, I'm not gonna.
Well, I think web browsers are sort of in the forefront of this. The lock icon is the most iconic form of understanding encryption or indicating it to one person. And this really is one bit of information. There's on and off. It doesn't encapsulate the whole myriad ways in which encryption does and does not happen. So I think a lot of work needs to be done in advertising, in advertising to users in a comprehensible way what encryption is happening. And really formulating simple descriptions of what's enough, right? And the web browser, yes, you have a lock icon, you know that there is HTTPS, you know sort of what that means, it's encryption from you to the browser, but what about apps? What about apps on your phone? Or what about back-end systems? Or what about anything else that, as you said, with the fridge, doesn't have a display, doesn't have a way to naturally communicate it to the user. So I think this is one of the biggest challenges faced in encryption going forward.
So we've come to that time to get questions from you all. Any hot burning questions for our panelists about where encryption happens or different types of encryptions what it doesn't touch, anything, all things encryption, by all means. We've got Drew here who has a microphone who can grab any of your questions.
Yeah, and just as a reminder for the folks who are watching over the stream, you can also tweet questions at hashtag Crypto Summit, and we'll be keeping an eye there. So while you think of questions, I do have a couple more things to bring up. If you did join late, if you came in either during the break or during the session, you can grab your badge at any time. It's just right outside this door in the back. We do have plenty of seats up front. If you've joined and the space is a little bit tight in the back, feel free to move to the front. Also, we did put a puzzle on each table. It has been solved, but what we're going to do is each group that solves it at the end of the day, we're going to put it into a pool and pick one, which will get that team will get a prize. So if you haven't yet looked at it, take a good glance at that puzzle. Let's move to questions.
Hi, I'm Mike Godwin. My question is, can you talk a little bit about the intersection of use of tools like VPNs and use of other consumer-facing tools like Find My iPhone?
All right, so you mean what's the intersection between those? All right, so VPN is going to provide you with a layer that is going to encrypt your traffic through. But Find My iPhone is actually an app that is going to connect your GPS, find your location, use the internet that it's connected to find your place and send you data back. You need VPN to transfer this data because if it's not encrypted, maybe someone in the middle can get access and find your phone before you.
Yeah, it's one on top of the other. Location information is, at least with in terms of Find My iPhone, satellite type things, is a receive type of information. So you receive information from satellites. You don't necessarily transmit them. So if you want to use Find My iPhone with a VPN, you can do so. The piece of information that identifies where you are is sent through the encrypted tunnel, and no one can kind of sniff that or figure it out on the wire. Only Apple will figure out what it is.
So I should point out there's been some attention in the security community recently about observing that, you know, maybe not all VPNs are equally trustworthy. If you're routing your traffic through someone, you should be aware of who that entity is. And this came as a shock to some people. But I think you follow the model of follow the data and then learn as much as you can. That gets to the transparency point you were making earlier. Mm-hmm.
Looks like we have one other question over there. And we have one in the back.
Thank you. This is Ali Akbar Mousavi from the International Campaign for Human Rights in Iran. Yes.
Sorry,
we have recommended to Google and Mozilla to add a VPN service or bundle it by setting or by default, like when they did for HTTPS search engine that we recommended previously. But they have a lot of delay on that, to implementing this service. Also, Mozilla, how the government or private sector or other, like you, can help them and, guide that why they have that much delay.
I think
it's very important and very useful, especially in the country like in Iran.
I think Google is working with the University of Washington on a project called UProxy, which allows you to open a tunnel between another trusted part at the other side of the internet, that he can provide you with a tunnel through its machine to communicate. But the project is still beta, so that means Google is working on that. I think is it's a browser plugging actually that you can install on Firefox browser or Google Chrome browser, and it's a plugging, so it allows you to use somebody else's internet traffic. I think it's just beta. They are testing it. They are trying to make sure that it's secure because it's a security solution, so it must be secure. They have to run a lot of tests to make sure that it's working. No, it's not by default. It's you have to install it, activate it, trust somebody, and start the tunnel.
And that's an important point, trust somebody. As we talked about quite a few times here in the data center, this is a physical thing. If you're running a VPN service, you need to have computers in a data center and physically ship them there, plug cables in, make agreements with other internet companies to be able to either peer or to buy traffic from them. It's actually a pretty challenging thing to do from a business perspective.
And speaking to the economic side, the benefit of building it into the browser is that everyone can use it. The downside of building something to the browser from the perspective of an organization or a state that does not want everyone to use it is it becomes a much, much larger target. And so anytime, and certainly this is what organizations like Access focus on, is how do you strike that balance of making sure that the tool that you're trying to share with people doesn't actually become a new target, doesn't get in its own way by its own popularity.
Right, and I mean, it's not just, you know, does it become, it's the tool itself being a target, but the use of that tool identifying at-risk users on a network, for example. So if it all of a sudden on the wire has a specific fingerprint, it makes it a lot easier for adversaries to target those individuals that use it. So there's a lot of different pieces at play that you have to consider when providing a security solution by default for all people. Now, that being said, there is some benefit that if browsers did have some of these things on by default, it would create a lot of noise, and therefore it would be it would make it less easy for people to identify those at-risk users. But it's getting that adoption. It's getting that transparency around. It's building trust. It's user education. There are a lot of components.
Hi, I'm Adam Eisgrau with the American Library Association. Thanks for a great panel and a great summit, which I understand is trending on Twitter in DC and Philly. So let's see if we can't get it to trend every place. Crypto in the details doesn't really lend itself to sound bites, but that's not going to stop me from inviting each of the panelists to compose an on-the-spot tweet along the lines of, if you are not VPNing,
use HTTPS.
You're doing it wrong.
We have to do a better job of educating you.
Encrypt in other ways.
But I would like to point out that there is a cat on the cartoon board now, as requested by somebody on Twitter, so we made it happen. There's a cat.
Because that's what we use all of our VPNs for, right, is to watch cat videos without people knowing.
So I'm John Canfield. On VPNs, I think my biggest problem is for open source tools, you have people auditing, you have people looking at the code. For VPNs, you have their marketing claims and the once a year torrent freak interview of, are you doing what you say you're doing? And they say yes. How do we build trust with a VPN provider who may or may not actually be doing what they say they're doing?
I think John knows. I mean, I deal with VPNs a lot because in countries, Middle East, for example, countries especially like Syria or Iran, VPN is the most wanted service for users back there because it's provide them fast internet comparing to Tor network, for example. I think it's really hard, John, to trust any VPN providers. So I see now that there are a lot of VPS companies, like hosting companies, servers company, they are providing pre-installed VPN servers. So you can go ahead, purchase $5 small VPS that it's already pre-installed, pre-configured, and use your own VPN. Use your own keys that you generated. You have to trust the internet service provider, and that might be a little bit easier than trusting a VPN provider that is located in the middle of nowhere. So I think we might really change our strategy in picking on VPNs and pick our own VPN servers.
Hi, my name is Maha Shtaki. I'm with Internews. Quick question, you hinted, you spoke a little bit about metadata earlier and how you're still able to, if you spend enough time and effort, you still kind of intelligently can make a determination just looking at the metadata of information as it travels through these different hops. And so my question is, Can you talk a little bit about what's going on in that space? What are we doing? Who's working on addressing issues around metadata and protecting privacy, user privacy? Thanks.
Well, so let's start with the first piece, I guess. What's happening in the metadata, right? The metadata is all the little bits and pieces of information about your system, your browser, your IP, your headers, all these things that the network or the site need to pass back and forth to identify you and to I guess shake hands with you, right? So when you're using a regular old browser and we're just day-to-day stuff, right? I may send a document, you know, to one of these guys, and I think, okay, it's just the document. But what you don't realize is part of that document is going to be metadata. So you send the document, and the document looks the way you think it's supposed to look, right? Maybe a bad guy intercepts the document and extracts the metadata. The metadata could be, as a worst-case scenario, the name that you used when you registered your software with Microsoft, all the edits that have been made to that document, timestamps on that document, your IP address, the location where you were when you sent that document. So metadata is, can I say dangerous?
It is dangerous. I remember once I sent a work email to a friend of mine who at that time was in Baghdad. By mistake, it was encrypted, PGP encrypted, but the subject of the email had a lot of information. So metadata is subject of the email, it's my email address, his email address, my IP address, all of this information. So just to answer your question, yes, now there is a software called Perio. It was developed by a group of developers and cryptographers. Actually, they addressed that exactly a problem. So they build a box, and inside that box, you're transferring data through their own server. So you're talking to the server, encrypted, using your own key. At the same time, the other side, they have a key to decrypt that text. So even the server has no access to this data. And they remove the metadata from your message. So even your metadata is encrypted through Perio box, let's say that. Yeah.
So just very quickly, we're delving into the question of what is it that...
Sorry, just one sec. We do have one. We've got to acknowledge the audience that's participating remotely. So we want to just pose that question quickly.
Very quickly, so for example, just looking at HTTPS, if there's no encryption, no HTTPS, then anyone sitting... intercepting the traffic and find out that I'm talking to twitter.com/accessnow. With HTTPS, you won't find out that I'm looking at the AccessNow Twitter feed, but you will still know that I'm talking to Twitter. And so you can go up from there. It is very hard to have any exchange that doesn't leak any data. And the more data you are concerned about leaking, the harder you have to work to prevent it.
So the last little bit of her question was who's trying to protect it, and just the simple answer is that we need to do a lot more. Like, we need to do better protecting metadata, and we need to understand, you know.
Okay, from the Twitter sphere, we've got two questions about Apple. The first is from Schaff, and the second is from John LaPrize. Do you believe companies such as Apple have a backdoor key in their full disk encryption system, and then retweeting but adding a comment using that great new Twitter feature that we all love? John LaPrize asks, better question, does Apple have control of its supply chain to foil hardware firmware backdoors?
How would we know the answer to that? Like, how would we know? We could like ask Steve Jobs maybe. I would say assume everybody has access to your data, but I'm a paranoid fruit, so.
So I, on the supply chain question, this is something that in the last 3 years, large companies have become very serious about this. The U.S. government has started to take this very seriously because it's not just a risk to privacy, it's an issue, it's a risk to national security. The same supply chain that sources Apple, the companies that make fighter jets use to design their new missiles.
And so this is something that everyone really cares about as a key priority.
I mean, we all just saw what happened with Lenovo, right? And Superfish and supply chain's a thing, so.
I think it's a religion question, encrypted or not. But recently I read, for example, an article for Bruce Schneier who said iMessaging, for example, is a very good encryption. But I might not agree with him because we don't know the answer. It's really hard to address that.
So unfortunately, we're running out of time. Any last minute statements that our panelists would like to make? If not, I'd like to thank Nick and Kimber and Allan and Dlshad. If you would, please give our panelists a round of applause. All right, everybody, we are going straight into our speed presentations. These are going to be presentations that we feel are going to bring up really important topics that may not get addressed on the panels, and we want to make sure that we expose you audience members to other things that are being discussed around encryption. So without further ado, I'm going to kick our amazing session two speakers off the stage and introduce back-to-back Daniel Schuman from Demand Progress and Lindsay Beck from the Open Technology Fund.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I believe this counts as the category of and now from something entirely different. Thank you all for inviting me, and I do want to congratulate Access for holding such a successful summit on the vital issue of encryption. I think at the outset it's important to say that encryption is part of a suite of technology and privacy issues that have kept things fairly interesting of late up on Capitol Hill. And as we saw recently, grassroots energy and activism around surveillance and around net neutrality have provided an educational opportunity for members of Congress. And right now, of course, Congress is in the process of mangling encryption. A senator who I should but probably will not name recently compared encryption to poisonous waste dumped into our rivers and streams. And he argued that companies pushing for real encryption are harming the public. And I can see that everyone here looks like you're being harmed right now. It's not entirely surprising that members of Congress are getting this issue wrong, at least that they're getting it wrong right now. Congress has increasingly diminished its ability to understand complex policy issues. The number of committee staff in the House, for example, have dropped by 50% over the last three decades. Expert agencies inside the legislative branch have been cut to the bone. Congress is at the mercy of special interests for information and guidance. And there is no interest more special than the defense establishment, which literally has offices on Capitol Hill and places staff in member offices. That is why grassroots pressure is so important. We can push them away from simplistic narratives. We can drive them out of the bubble. We can force them to engage with the people most expert on encryption, the people in this room, and the millions of Americans who are behind the work that we're doing. Grassroots pressure also helps change the narrative about encryption and widens the range of policy options. For example, last year's Reset the Net campaign encouraged developers to make their websites more secure from prying and encouraged internet users to use NSA-resistant privacy tools. By getting more people to use encryption, the Reset the Net campaign worked towards three important goals. First, it made the use of encryption more commonplace, showing that it's not scary and it's not that complicated. Second, it taught how the widespread use of encryption can protect everyone from surveillance, like mass inoculation against virulent diseases. And finally, it encouraged policymakers to find a solution that is proportionate and appropriate to the problem it is trying to address. A campaign raising awareness around encryption, however, no matter how clever, is only part of the battle. People must connect encryption to bigger fights and broader organizing efforts. To win on encryption, it must be seen as a brick in the wall against an overly intrusive government and against hackers. And that wall must be built around opposition to the USA Patriot Act. It must be built around skepticism around the Communications Assistance for Law Enforcement Act, to deep concern around the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, to dread around Executive Order 12333, and so on. We have won unprecedented victories lately by educating and organizing around these issues. Hundreds of thousands of people weighed in on mass surveillance. We must apply those lessons to encryption and help people connect the dots. They must come to understand the fight is about the future of privacy. It's about the future of technology, and it's about the future of democracy. We have made good headway, but there is so much more to do. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. These are tough times for advocates of free expression worldwide. We're seeing creation and implementation of increasingly repressive laws that curtail access to an open internet, shutdown of telecommunications in times of political turmoil, and escalation and censorship of keywords and images, which severely inhibit the ability to organize and communicate openly. As technological efforts have made inroads to safeguard communication online, so too have repressive regimes responded in kind. Procurement of corporate surveillance technologies to directly monitor activities of human rights organizations and activist networks, such as in Ethiopia and Bahrain. Encouragement of local technologists to disrupt functionality of Tor and other circumvention technologies, like in Russia. And the spawn of a new attack mechanism known as Great Cannon are just a few examples of increasingly sophisticated techniques to impede communication protected from censorship and surveillance. Even with these escalated tactics, there are other challenges that still remain. Many citizens still rely on widely available but otherwise untrustworthy applications or platforms to communicate and conduct their online activities. Under-resourced organizations in developing countries still use pirated copies of proprietary software to document and share their data, and activists leverage popular but insecure mobile applications in order to quickly disseminate information. A notable example was during the protests in Hong Kong, where demonstrators used FireChat to mobilize, yet faced risk of surveillance and arrest as messages were sent unencrypted over the network. Because of the limited abilities for individual users to detect and counteract these ongoing and increasingly repressive tactics, activists, journalists, and other human rights defenders and their networks remain at risk of harassment, arrest, or worse. The Open Technology Fund supports technology-centric efforts that empower world citizens to have access to modern communication channels that are free of restrictions and allow them to communicate without fear of repressive censorship or surveillance. Over the 3-year history of our program, OTF supports projects that advance research into repressive internet interference and the needs of users operating in such environments. These include first-of-its-kind studies of the privacy and security needs of activists within the Tibetan diaspora and in Vietnam, the detection of sock puppets used to crowd out independent voices on social media platforms, and through fellowship programs with trusted institutions to document the latest tactics underway to control the spread of information online. OTF also fosters development of technologies that circumvent repressive censorship and surveillance or increase communication and safety by advancing the techniques used by widely relied upon anti-censorship tools to more easily overcome next-generation blocking techniques. These include expanding access to bridges and flash proxies to more easily access the Tor network, and the utilization of new approaches such as domain fronting to act as a countermeasure to online censorship. We also support technologies that make it easy to follow digital security best practices, such as development of secure operating systems that allow a user to safely access content despite utilizing an untrusted machine, and tools that help users easily verify their downloads of digital security tools. However, this research and development is only helpful if it can be used by affected individuals. OTF also encourages the widespread implementation of these technologies by supporting awareness raising around digital security issues through mechanisms such as online campaigning and tutorials among Southeast Asian human rights networks and partnerships between East African innovation hubs and internet policy researchers to test the efficacy of secure communication tools for local human rights defenders. To better enable the widespread use of internet freedom tools, partnerships between technologists and traditional human rights organizations are welcome developments, as well as efforts by larger companies to increase default security features in devices, utilize trusted cryptographic protocols leveraged or developed by internet freedom technology projects, or enable access to their products via circumvention tools or other digital security tools. Such efforts from the private sector, civil society, academia, and the technology community lower the barrier for users to harness tools and techniques that ultimately keep their data and themselves safe. While there are still many obstacles ahead to fully ensure secure communications that are ultimately free of censorship and surveillance, working together as a community on the side of free expression, we can continue to create and evolve solutions that best help persons at risk, and effectively challenge upcoming obstacles to an open internet. Thank you.
Up next is Access's policy director, Rahman Chima. Before joining Access, he was at Google. He's a leading voice on free expression and tech policy in the developing world. Please welcome Rahman.
Good afternoon, everyone. So the topic of my brief presentation is encryption policy and its impact on the global internet. And the reason I wanted to just stress that is, and this is something I think that's come across from many different speakers and lots of conversations in the run-up to the crypto summit and in the sideline conversations that many people have been having here. But it's that this conversation might be happening in DC. This is the first event that we're doing here. But it's a global issue and a global conversation. And in fact, in many ways, what happens even in the US in terms of discussions around federal policy and federal law regarding encryption, regarding crypto as a broader subject, impacts the entire world. And that's, in fact, in many ways, the reason why Access helped support and organize this event. As you might have heard at the beginning, we talked about Access's mission, and the mission is to help protect and advance the digital rights of users across the world. And that's the point that I just wanted to stress here. The reason why encryption is such an important issue even for us is we have staff based across the world who help provide assistance on technology issues that affect users, but also public policy and advocacy issues that affect the internet community. And nearly everyone can certify to the fact that right now we're at a critical phase. We're at a point of time where encryption discussions in many ways, driven by conversations in the US, are affecting the broader, let's say, principles and balance issues of balance that are there in tech policy globally. What I just wanted to give you a bit more is in terms of background. So as Blue mentioned, I used to work previously at Google. I helped support and expand the public policy team for Google in India and work on Asia public policy issues. I also worked in free expression research before that. But the thing that I wanted to like draw out the most there is nearly during the entire time I've done tech policy or internet policy, there hasn't been 6 months when I haven't had someone bring up a question about encryption, the question about what the US did about it previously, the crypto wars which you heard so much in the first panel, but also statements from different officials or legislators about what should happen next or what is happening now. As I mentioned, it's a conversation that's happening here. It's a conversation happening in DC and across the United States. It's also a conversation, as many of you are aware, happening in global world capitals. Many of you would have heard statements from the UK Prime Minister, David Cameron, talking about encryption, talking about security and law enforcement needs. What I wanted to draw attention is it's not just that headline. It's not just, for example, what David Cameron has said about encryption. These conversations in deep policy terms have been happening across the world in many different places. If many of you are interested in this, I encourage you to read work from one of our panelists who took part via distant participation, Peter Swire. He's written about this. Several others have as well. But for example, deep technical questions or legal questions about encryption policy have been happening in China, they've been happening in India, they've been happening across Asia Pacific and more recently in the European Union across EU member states as well. And I think it's important that we understand what states are sometimes trying to do there. Some countries are directly going into questions about new regulations or government measures to either regulate encryption more strongly, restrict action to encryption technologies, or in some ways redefine how encryption products work at that very top level. For example, this is a conversation that's happened in Beijing with regards to not just the cybersecurity policy, but questions about the import of telecom equipment, the questions around the accessibility of over-the-top applications and services, online web communication apps, and elsewhere. You have other countries which have looked at encryption somewhat, but they've left questions open, and by leaving those questions open also, they sometimes caused issues with regards to its usage. For example, in my home country of India, you could argue, and this is a question that's always worth its weight, you can ask a lawyer, what is the status of encryption policy in India? They will come back and say, it's really complicated. And at the end of that conversation, normally most people will do is that they'll consider that it's not worth launching a new product or service. But let me give you a sense of, for example, how the decision on encryption policy was taken there. They decided, not for all services, but on telecommunications networks, because telecom providers in India, like in many countries, have to take a government license. They were asked that you cannot deploy any communication service there which exceeds 40 bits. So as you can imagine, that's not exactly something that's either workable or useful. The interesting element of that being that that restriction is technically there on telecom companies. You could argue, does it apply to services that use their channels, that use their networks? Most people would have said, no, it's just a legacy government regulation, it won't continue. But in a sense, it was used. And when people brought up law enforcement and security concerns after the 2008 Bombay terror attacks, which some of you might be familiar with, subsequent to that, across 2 or 3 years, the Indian government decided that some encrypted services seemed to be a threat. And when some law enforcement agencies brought the conversation forward, they essentially told telecom providers that a service like Research in Motion's BlackBerry should not be allowed to be deployed on the network. We can't perhaps tell BlackBerry to do this. That was the position perhaps taken behind the scenes across Indian government agencies. But we can tell telecom providers, no, you cannot allow the service to be used. And what's interesting in all of these discussions, and like I just give you the Indian example as well, is whenever all of this has occurred, the one thing that most people will cite in any of those conversations is, look, even policymakers in the US, across Western Europe or even elsewhere, even they seem to have concerns around encryption. We heard a statement 6 months ago from someone saying that it's a challenge to law enforcement agencies, that they want to re-look at how encryption policy has been set. Or in some cases, it's also people not fully understanding the implications of the policy choices that were made during the crypto wars in the late 90s. What's most important to therefore understand is that what the United States does in this, what other governments do as well, but perhaps particularly not just the US government, but policymakers, actors in the US, companies, web developers, anyone who works on this issue, it has a ripple effect. It's something that even if there's a question about, we believe that we agree on 80% of the conversation, but 20% or maybe 15% there's disagreement across people who work on encryption policy in the US. That disagreement is the element that's amplified. That's something that struck me. I remember someone even just yesterday mentioning that on most issues, crypto supporters and law enforcement agree. It's just a few things where they disagree. But those points of disagreement, A, of course, set the standards that will affect how everyone else in the US will use this in the future, but also how everyone across the world will also use encryption. Every time there's been a conversation across either the United States or the United Kingdom or even elsewhere about the standards regarding encryption or cryptology, that's been an immediate point to help create further conversations across governments, whether they be democratic states like India, whether they be conversations across government officials or regulators in places like China or elsewhere, that look, the conversation needs to be addressed in a new way. Even the people who have developed these services, who are the strongest supporters of this, believe something new needs to be done. So it's just a simple reminder, a check that whatever is discussed here, whether it's in DC or whether it's in Silicon Valley, has immediate global impact, even if it's just doubt, even if you choose not to do certain things, but people believe that, look, we need to relook certain things. A chain of discussion and policy conversations is triggered. Why this is particularly important, and this is something that the previous speaker also mentioned, is that it's actually the most important for the entire internet. Right now, less than half of the world's population is online, and the majority of people coming online right now are mostly in the developing world. Even today, for example, the top internet population base in the world is China, then it's the United States, and then it's India. And then you see the most rapid progress of internet access and development is across many countries in Southeast Asia, even portions of Africa, who are doing this. And in many of these countries, either they have legal frameworks that are being updated, or they have legal frameworks that they are trying to create in place. And whenever any lawmaker or regulator looks at this issue there, they will look at the question of, look, what has happened in the US on this? what has happened in Europe on this. And they take direction sometimes on what occurs there. They may take a different viewpoint, but very often, when there's a clamp down on certain measures, they will say, look, certain people want this to be done, even in countries which seem to support openness or radical openness in many ways. And that's the important thing. Sometimes people mention that it doesn't matter what government does on encryption. I'm actually a huge skeptic of that, because the reality is that, yes, people can always figure out ways to sometimes break regulations or bypass or have secure communications on their own. But the objective that all of us need to have is secure communications for all the world's peoples. The majority of people who are right now going to be online on the internet are people who have never been online before. So whatever regulation or uncertainty is created over the next 6 months to 12 months to 2 years will affect how the internet is used for the next decade. And I want to leave you with that. So as you have conversations or hear discussions in the remaining sessions here at the Crypto Summit, and as you discuss and take place, conversation take place after this, just keep in mind that whatever occurs here isn't just something for the US and isn't even just something for now. It's something that's going to affect the next 3 billion people who are going to go online, and it's really going to impact what sort of internet they have and how it can be used for them meaningfully. And with that, I'm going to end. Thank you.
Thank you, Roman. We are now going to break for lunch. For those of you in the room, that means we're going to let you go out into the hallway and grab some food and some drink, and we're going to ask you to be back in your seats at around 12:35 so we can get started on time. For those on the stream, we'll see you back here at that time exactly. And the conversation, as always, will continue on Twitter through the break. So I'll see you all back here in about an hour.